stop service to Incheon is now in the final boarding passenger gate 91. We need all confirmed and ticketed passengers to board the aircraft. Once again, final call for United Airlines 893, non-stop service to Incheon.
On 7 Sundays out of every year, they race the clock searching for the elusive perfect run.
It's an adventure, you know, you set out just kind of going, yeah, I'm leaving it all behind. You know, my house is back there and I'm going that way and I'm going racing and that's what I'm doing. 5 months out of the year, I drop everything and I'm off. And the only thing that's you're intently focused on is your racing.
When the snow melts, the ruts form, and these riders race on an evolved toy that we all grew up on. What do you call a sport that takes 3 minutes to complete? A sport that pushes you to the limit, both mentally and physically. A sport where the courses are as varied as the riders and the countries they are from.
You've got to make every split second count, and there's so many things on the track.
There's roots, there's trees, there's rocks, there's turns.
You've got dust, things covering holes that you don't even know exist. It's like a volatile surface. It's always changing and always different.
There's so many corners on a course, you've got to remember them. You've got to remember your lines. You've got to do the technical sections. You've got to get over the rocks and roots. And you've got to do it in the quickest time possible. And you don't know where your opponents are going or how fast they are on their race run. So you'd have no feeler gauge on what speed you have to go. You just have to go flat out as fast as you can in those 3 minutes.
And as soon as you get the slightest bit of doubt in your head in a downhill race, it's over, you're not gonna do good.
But when it comes time and you're in that start gate, there's nothing else in your head.
And we fight against the clock.
You race the clock, and that is your enemy. Every time that thing clicks over another second, you know, you're not where you're meant to be. You want to beat time. You have to get down there quicker than anybody else.
But when you come to the World Cup, you know, it's not just about who can go the fastest, it's about who can deal with the pressure and who can deal with the foreign culture and stuff. And you can get down the hill on the day the fastest with all those things against you.
Person on a bike riding down a trail, a marked trail, racing in between tape.
Santa Barbara, California's Duncan Riffle is the 2004 U.S. National Champion. After spending the last 3 seasons racing the U.S. National Series, Duncan has set out to race the entire World Cup Series for 2006.
My name's Duncan Riffle. I'm 19 years old from Santa Barbara, California. I definitely train hard, and I know when it comes time to, when I see a pedal section or when I hear that a course is 5 minutes long and it's extremely physical, I know that I'll be capable to deal with that. And I'm happy about that because I know I prepared properly.
Duncan's fear is being pigeonholed by his peers as a racer only capable of performing well on home soil.
It almost starts to sound like an excuse, people saying, well, that's at least you were top American. It's like, I don't want to hear that. I mean, I'd like to be top American on the top.
Last go!
This year in 06 was the first year I did the entire circuit nonstop, didn't miss a race, and I kind of set out to do it knowing that it was going to be difficult. In order to gain the confidence that I needed to compete on the World Cup circuit, I knew I had to do all of them so that it felt like my home, because, you know, I know it's where I belong.
Duncan, along with other racers from around the globe, will race 6 different stops around the world for the title of World Cup champion. And wherever these racers are from, they all have to step out of their element and into foreign cultures and places.
We're in Vigo, Spain today.
In Spain, it's harder to find English speakers as opposed to other places in Europe. So it can be just a mission. Little things like, yeah, paying the parking to get out of the airport.
I don't know what the fuck you do. Can you speak English? Yeah, you can.
Fucking lost my bike.
They lost it?
Yeah, well, that's what they said.
That's why I think, World Cup racing and what we do is so great, because, you know, we get to travel all over the world and experience so many different things, different cultures.
First World Cup this year was Vigo, Spain. First time I'd been there. It was really good to be there and just really looking forward to doing my first full World Cup season.
Jared Graves is the 2005 U.S. Norbit National Downhill and Gated Racing Champion. After securing both titles, Graves will race his first full World Cup Series in 2006.
That's the true test of the best person in our sport, is the World Cup champion, because he's got to be consistent, not get injured, he's got to be able to race on any type of course, he's got to be mentally strong over 6 months.
The World Cup Series of downhill mountain biking, it's the pinnacle, it's the toughest races.
Series of six races all over the world, and it's the best riders in the world competing against each other in different countries, different tracks, so you can get the best result and win the overall.
Sam Hill has been the runner-up of the World Cup Series for the past 2 seasons. In 2006, Hill is aiming for one step higher, World Cup champion.
It's the first race of the season, so you don't really know where you line, and
difficult because, you know, like, you never know if you're ready or not. You know, like, the thing is, if you find out that you need to be short on training, or you don't work enough on your staff, you know you're going to have a hard season, because you're not going to train now, you know, after the first World Cup, it's done.
Greg Minnaar is last year's World Cup champion. He also won it in 2001, when he was just 19 years old. A crash in his race run here in Vigo would see him start the season way back in 19th place. And come down and put your heart in this fight. I'll come on and make your stand tonight. Steve Peat is a 2-time winner of the World Cup Series and has been racing downhill longer than any other active racer. In his 12th consecutive year racing the World Cup Series, Peat is as hungry as ever for the World Cup title.
I ended up second. I had a pretty good run, and Mick was the last one to come down the hill. And I was kind of betting on that Mick might mess it up, because he sometimes does, so I thought I might have won, but then
really stoked for Mick to actually make it down the hill for once and come into first place. And I was happy with second. I mean, Australia first and second.
It was cool to see him win this year in Vigo, because I don't think he's won a race since he kind of busted onto the scene in Big Bear back when he was riding an orange for the global team.
Mick Hanna broke onto the international scene when he was just 16 years old at the 2001 Sea Otter Classic. He would almost beat mountain bike icon Brian Lopes in the dual slalom that year. Then Mick went on to win both the slalom and downhill at the first U.S. National of the year a month later. It would take him another 5 years, however, to win his first World Cup. Mick would now travel to the next World Cup round in Scotland with the leader's jersey in hand. But first, riders would travel just a few hours south to the neighboring country of Portugal and to the city of Lisbon for a rather unconventional downhill race. Instead of dirt and mountains, riders raced down the streets of historic downtown Lisbon, Portugal.
Lisbon is a totally different event to any other event that we do in the season. It's basically a street race. It starts in a castle at the top of the old town of Lisbon, and it comes down cobbled streets, alleyways, marble floors, sets of stairs. You've got scaffolding, railing, plant pots, old women's knickers hanging off the lines, dripping water on you, and it's just fans hanging in off the sides. It's just a totally different kind of race.
When you start in like in town, like at the top, in like all these sort of historical like places, and everyone comes out like pouring out, like watching out the houses and stuff through the windows, and it's cool, like down the steps with the dogs running everywhere and stuff. I'm all about the look that you're giving me. I'm all about the dance moves you're letting free. Well, I'm all about a sweet sound and loving spree. So listen for my melody. And maybe I'm caught up in the thing that you know I like. You check it one time, baby, overnight. See, we could make a grand escape, or we can roll high by the way.
So many people come out to watch, fully televised. Just really cool atmosphere, and all the people they're watching, like there's thousands upon thousands of people they're watching, and they all think you're just, you know, they think the riders are rock stars kind of thing, so it's a bit of a different atmosphere to what we're used to.
The Lisbon track is actually pretty hard to race. I mean, I think you really need a bit of experience there. You only get limited amount of practice, and it's just a cool race where you can get really inside the city and the people can see exactly what we're all about.
People have never seen people riding downhill bikes come out and watch the race, and they love it. They're nuts.
When we race in the street with big bikes, you know, like they think we're crazy. For us, it's just normal. But for these people, they only see soccer and TVs, and you know, they don't even know that a sport like this exists. Then when they see it, I think they enjoy it. That's why I think it's good as well, because you know, like we're always so far from big cities and stuff. It's good for once to bring the sport to the people.
There's people that probably never even seen a bike, and they're leaning in, going crazy, shouting for you because you're flying past their houses and riding through the streets that they walk through every day. So it definitely brings it to the masses. If you can't bring those people to the mountains, then put on a race like that and we take the race to them.
The whole way down the course is just packed, you know, people deep, up in some places like six people deep, just watching the riders go past. And some of the shots, like the photography shots you'll get there, just shows how amazing a race it is.
Petey's been around for a long time. He's been on top for I don't even know how many years. You think he'd be getting slower, but he still gets faster, and he just knows what needs to happen, and he's real smooth and consistent, knows how to do it.
Steve won Lisbon again I think he's won for 5 years in a row now, which is really cool. And like, you know, he's just an all-around mountain bike guy. So like, that's pretty good to win 5 years in a row on a track that isn't that long.
Lisbon, I won this year. That's the fifth time in a row that I've won that race. I got the street racing down at that place. Oh baby, that's
without a doubt, Steve Pete is the quintessential downhill racer. What Michael Jordan is to basketball and Tony Hawk is to skateboarding, Steve Pete is to downhill. He's won more World Cups than any racer still racing today and seems as hungry as ever. But wins aside, Petey is simply a good guy and a good ambassador for the sport. His fans agree.
After Lisbon, we headed back to my homeland and up to Scotland for Fort William.
Track at Fort William, I think, is probably the most physical track of all. Basically, you've got 3 minutes of the roughest track you've ever seen, and then the next 2 minutes is just physical pedaling.
It's like nothing else that you ride during the season. Flat out drifting turns, but still like some of the most technical wood sections on the whole race circuit.
Brutal track, Scotland, man.
The weather in Fort William this year, however, was absolutely horrendous.
Ping me up in 24 hours to tie your blue sense to make amends. Cause I said it all, I started to fall in the silence.
Following his win at the first round in Vigo, Mick Hanna would now lead the series and race in freezing temperatures.
It was bloody cold there and high winds.
So open to the elements, there's like no trees or anything, it's always windy and raining. And
go to Scotland, it seems like every year it's, I don't think we've ever been there when it hasn't rained.
I think is one of the best events in the mountain bike industry, and it's in the middle of nowhere.
Well, Scotland's a bit of a weird race, I mean, because it is kind of in the middle of nowhere, but still it gets the biggest crowds and the people are really enthusiastic.
But at this time, you know, when we have this World Cup, like the town is packed, you know, and that's great.
Yeah, the fans are nuts, like, and it is just in the middle of nowhere. Come race day, just like all the fans just rock up and it's just like transforms the place, you know, it's just queues of people trying to get into the race camp, into the pit area. Every like pit stand's just rammed with people trying to get to see the races and see all the athletes. It's an absolutely amazing atmosphere.
That's just a man's track. It's rough from top to bottom, rocks from top to bottom. Got to be so fit and strong to ride there. It's a rad track, the atmosphere's amazing. This year was just no different to any other year. There's so many people there. Go down, you feel a bit tired, and then look to the side and there's 20 people shouting for you. This gives you a boost and just makes you go even faster. It's so good.
It's rough. Yeah, so it's one word you can say. It's, and holes, just holes, holes and more holes. All the fans in Scotland, they nuts. They're so loud. It's awesome, like when you're coming towards the finish area, they're just like cheering you. It's awesome. And there's always like so many people.
But it's for sure the best race in terms of spectators and just the vibe you get from racing there. Everyone just so into the sport and the biggest crowds at the bottom. And they're really patriotic for the British riders and that's good to see, man. They're into the sport over there.
Tons of people, weather was shitty again, no surprises really. Track is starting to get really blown out and rocky and just exposed everything there. So it's getting harder and harder every year, harder on the body. Every year the times get a bit slower there because it's getting rougher.
It's the best event of the year, every year. Obviously you got home fans there. cheering for me, and everybody supports me at that race, which is really cool for me. It's a 4-minute track, which is quite long in our sport, and you get to get into the arena and you bust in through this Tiso arch over a jump, and it just erupts, the crowd just erupts and it just goes crazy. And it's such a good feeling to know that people support our sport in that way and are that passionate about watching it.
After getting the sex at Vigo, I was a little bit upset, so I wanted to come back and try and make up some good ground points, and ended up coming out of after that race with a leader's jersey.
Why is Sam so good? You know, that's a good question, and I'm pretty sure nobody can answer that. My best explanation would be confidence. There's no doubt in your mind that when you go to a race and you see Sam, he is 100% confident in what he is capable of. He knows what he can do, he knows what he has to do to get there, and he does it.
Pretty much after Vigo, I thought if I get back in the top three before we go to Mont St. Anne, I'd be in a pretty good position for the overall, so to come back and be leading right now is awesome.
Yeah.
It's going to be a tough year, there's so many people that can win, and that's shown the last two races. You know, Mick was leading, and now I don't know what he finished today, but...
Yeah.
The people that did good in Vigo kind of got pushed out a little bit, so...
Are you feeling any more, like, pressure per se? I know you kind of can't really think about it right now, but...
No pressure on me. Dude, I don't do pressure.
Between downhill racing is a lot of passion, a quality best exemplified by a downhill racing dynasty, the Atherton family of Great Britain. While racing is the Athertons' passion, they spend their time outside the tape building, riding, and training on tracks on their home soil of Wales. Starts with one, I can feel. It's all in your mind, Daddy, where I can feel.
Make me feel this way. My name's Rachel Atherton, I'm 18, I'm from Great Britain. I don't remember ever deciding, you know, that I want to be a professional downhiller, or just sort of fell into it, really. Now there's two I can't see. I've never felt this way. I can't feel
anything anywhere. It's sugar. I guess going away all the time, my sister wanted to kind of come along and take part as well, so just to kind of humour her, we got her a bike as well, just to keep her happy, and then suddenly she's bloody winning World Cups. Rachel's older brother, G, is the Atherton's most successful racer. A former World Cup winner in 2004, G, still only 21, has proved he is one of the world's best.
Hey, my name's Dan Atherton. I'm 24 years old. I'm from Wales, England.
Dan is the one that got both Rachel and G into riding and racing. If it weren't for Dan, the Atherton dynasty would not exist.
For as long as I can remember, I've been riding bikes, you know. There's a reason for why you're still here and you're still racing downhill, is because, you know, you love it.
It feels so good. It feels
definitely something different. Like it kind of opens your eyes to things when you're living with them. Like they all get on really well and like support each other, and they definitely have something unique going, which like three members of the family all racing World Cups.
Ben Reid is the Atherton's good friend. He is undoubtedly Ireland's most successful downhill racer at the moment, but unlike the factory-supported Atherton family, Reid pays his own way to races and funds the majority of his summers on his own. And what Reid lacks in factory support, he more than makes up for in heart.
I've always wanted to ride a bike like most people, professionals that are riding their bikes. I thought I may as well give it a go rather than 10 years down the line say, why didn't I try? So I just enjoy riding my bike. Like every day I have to be on some sort of bike or I can't sleep. Like two wheels of any sort, mini bike or motocross bike or something. So I wouldn't want to be doing anything else.
Miss the next World Cup in Willingen, Germany, for personal reasons, but shares the sentiment of his fellow racers about the course.
After Fort William, most of the riders went over to Germany. I didn't go because I had like minimal funds this year, so I had to be careful where I spend it. I thought I'd be better spending it on races, which I felt I have a good chance in doing well.
Oh, Willingen sucks. There's nothing to do in Germany over there. It's cold, it's windy.
Kind of a strange track, you know, for a downhill.
Willingen is different track.
Track in Germany is very different to all the other courses. It's like all man-made and just jumps. And it's pretty short too.
Willingen is probably the world's worst downhill track. I think it's absolute shit. I mean, everyone said this year it was a lot better, but that ain't my idea of downhill. But it's just a lack of gradient at the top as well. It's just like a huge BMX track.
And while the majority of the riders dislike the course, they're all there to do one thing, race. Following his win at the previous round in Scotland, Sam Hill, for the first time in his career, would wear the leader's jersey on a course that did not suit him.
Play more shows than most attended. I make my dough, then go and spend it. I earn my title, quasi-famous, pseudo-celebrity. Yo, it's Johnny, ain't it? Smith's in with a Z, he's ready to break north like said G. Step in the catwalk, straight across so messily. Getting the jakes off, yo, let's say you never met me. I ain't trying to get thrown in a can like Pepsi. I'm sort of like dead prez, dying trying to get dead free. Next video, no kidding on water guns and jet skis. I need a vacation, man, cause I'm a bookie. Owner, janitor, and bookie. The vinylist spends his days in the lab. Good looking rapper, even though it's tall beer and short sleeves.
get cold hands. By 30, I'll display my age as an old man. Baby face with no cracks. Give me 5 years, I'll take a hammer to the whole flat.
The downhill track, well, I don't dislike it, I don't like it. I mean, it's good to have something different in the race series. So I think it's good there, just for a different type of track. But still, I don't know, it's kind of just jumps and stuff. But it's fun, it's a whole lot of fun to ride, but it's not exactly the best race course ever. I think everyone will probably tell you the same thing there.
A little bit of beer money. Now I want the gun to make things clear. Money's when you throw that down on the table, it makes sense. You ain't about your BI, then it makes you chance. I won't commence. I'm getting that.
But unfortunately, this year has been just a couple mistakes, and at the World Cup level, you can't have mistakes. So I finished 16th, I think, pretty bummed. Wanted at least to stay in the top 10 for the final.
I'm also the manager, cause ain't no one else gonna push my career. Macaron and Honey Cup, but they got theirs. And still got beers to drink that ain't changed. Now I deserve them, won't be paying with change. Shit's so strange, our work make you jealous. From Furby to Ellis, reach us and tell us. I need the celly to be blowing up. Promoters calling like, yo, Pip, when you showing up? Never late, professional on time. Such a small part is just kicking around. Stick to the deadline, sign a contract. Press up a compact, send it to the contact. And hey, yo, we're on that out to fill the pouch. Fuck sitting around the house, smoking weed on the couch. Come on!
I ain't lazy. You can say I'm sort of the boss.
I ain't lazy.
I'm just the type of brother that's out to get mine.
It's a World Cup of races, so you have to have a mix up of everything. You can't have the same natural courses every week. I think it could get a bit much, so they have to throw in one or two. And I think they've had a pretty good job of making a decent course there. It could be way worse for that hill that they use. It's not even a mountain.
Yeah, it's good to be up there, but a win would be better, man.
Yeah.
I need to get up one more place.
I didn't really get it together until the sort of morning of the race. Once I'd got it together in my head, and I knew it was pretty easy. That was my first win of 06, and it was nice. I mean, since 98, I've been winning World Cups. I've won a World Cup every year since 98, and it gets harder and harder. I'm getting older, and a lot of the guys are looking at me as the old veteran of the sport, and I know I still got a lot for those guys, and I can win World Cups. And to get that first win of the year out of the way in Willingham was a big relief for me.
Is that a victory, Stella, Steve?
Yes, I like to celebrate when I win.
How many World Cup wins is this in your career?
By my tally, that's 15. What's the record?
Yeah.
The record is 16 by a certain Nico Voulios.
If there is one rider that epitomizes downhill racing, it is France's Nicolas Vuillot. Now retired, Vuillot collected 10 world championship titles in his 11-year career. Simply put, no rider today comes close to Nico's ways of winning.
For me, Nicolas Vuillot is the greatest rider of all time because he was the most consistent winner.
No one else has what he has on paper. 10-time world champion.
Greatest rider of all time, unfortunately, Steve, is Nicolas Vuillot. Steve is definitely the second greatest rider of all time. Can't take that away from him, and for longevity of career and stuff, and being at the top that long. But you can't take, I think, 10 world titles away from anyone, can you? I mean, Nico was unreal. I don't think you'll ever see anyone like him again. It was just different what he was doing. It was incredible.
Yeah, I'll give a little prop to Nicol, I think. I think the greatest ball Rob Warner of all time is Nicol Voulez. It's got to be. That guy was 10 times world champion. He was a little bit boring and some of the fans didn't relate to him. But at the same time, he was a tactician. He did what he needed to do to win races. And he's in the history books. I had a lot of second places for Nicol.
And while Vuillot is now retired, some things never change. Steve Peat and winning.
In my mind, Steve Peat is an incredible reader of bike tracks and how he can use his strengths in order to overcome any weaknesses he has on a particular bike track. I think Greg Minnaar has always been, you know, an incredibly consistent bike rider on any kind of course. And I would think that if they were to race Nico now, it'd be a very interesting matchup. I don't think it would be the domination that it used to be. I think we have progressed. In the young riders coming up, you know, I'm pretty impressed with guys like Brendan Fairclough. When they put it together, they, you know, a guy like him really knows what he's doing, and I think he'll be a, you know, a strong force in the future.
Mentored under Steve Peat, 18-year-old Brendan Fairclough is one of the fastest new riders to the sport. Combining an effortless style with an uncanny natural ability, Fairclough has the potential to be the next Steve Peat.
My name is Brendan Fairclough. I'm from Guildford in Hampshire in England, and I'm 18 years old.
Brendan Fairclough, you know, he's like so like happy and so excited just to be like going to like a national in England or just anything. It sort of does remind you like why you liked it in the first place. He's so excited, you know, to just be doing the simple thing.
Whether you got an injury or you have a couple of weeks off for some other reason, day you get back on your bike, it's the best day ever. Like you just you feel so at home, and that like adrenaline buzz of getting for a section fast and smooth. I haven't found anything that beat it yet. And now I'm in Brazil, in Austria, in France, wherever I am, it's just amazing.
2006 marks Fairclough's last year in juniors. He is a favorite to win the Junior World Championships later in the season in New Zealand.
What'd you end up?
No idea.
Yeah.
Haven't seen the results, but fairly off the back.
And did you drop back down in the points, or what happened with that?
Yeah, Steve will be leading now. I don't know what they'll put me, but everything should still be pretty tight, so we'll keep it going and see what happens.
With Steve Peat now wearing the leader's jersey, the World Cup Series would now travel across the Atlantic for the fourth round in Mount Saint Anne, Quebec, Canada.
Should be good. Looking to get some revenge.
After Germany, it was up to Canada. Mont Saint Anne, which is an incredible course.
It's a really fast, rough track, really technical in places. I think it's the ultimate downhill, in my opinion, is it has everything.
You pin the whole time, pretty much.
The track's just awesome. I loved it.
The downhill track was just so good this year. Just one of the best courses on the circuit, hands down.
I think it's sort of the Ironman track of World Cup downhill.
It's a lot better than Wellington.
And that's a cool track to go back to. They're running the full length track again like normal, and that's so physical and fast. It's kind of like Fort William, I suppose, but it's just like such a unique track.
awesome track, eh? Or like true test of pure downhill, you know, it's long, rough, pedaling fast. Great track.
I think it's the most physical track of the year, just like the way it's, just the length of it and what's in the course, it just batters riders to pieces. I think it really challenges the riders.
Next World Cup we went to after Willingen was one that I was really looking forward to. It was where my season took off in 2005, and I was hoping for sort of the same result. I qualified fourth and ended up fourth. Beat Steve that weekend, which was, any time you beat Steve is a result, so.
Once and then I was second, so, you know, another second, so that's always not good. But it's still good for points, you know, that's what we're aiming at.
Next.
Yeah.
Just missed the podium again, like, I don't know, sixth time by that much. So, good race, but wasn't enough again this time. We'll see hopefully next time. Seems to get closer, but seems to all the time get further, so I don't know.
Canada was won by Chris Kovarik. Pretty much a surprise for me. Like, I thought that I'd be able to have him covered at there, and he pulled one out. I think he won by 1.2, 1.3 seconds, so he pulled out a really good run, and it was cool to see him win and finally, like, sort of get his career back on track from when he broke his leg in 04.
Chris Kovarik's win at Mount St. Anne marks a full recovery from a near career-ending motorcycling accident in the fall of 2003. Chris would miss the entire following 2004 season after the accident. Many doubted if Kovarik could return to the top step of the podium. Chris silenced them all in Canada.
I'm thinking, shit, when's it gonna come, you know? Felt good on my bike, I was railing and drifting corners and just thinking, yeah, I'm kind of halfway back to my old self.
Petey's leading by, I think, a handful of points, 20, 30 points, which in World Cup racing, where 250s a win,
yeah,
you know, they're pretty well even now. So it's just going to come down to those last two races and, you know, it's always tough. It's tough being ahead with two races to go, it's tough chasing with two to go. And then Sam had a good day today. I haven't done his points yet. He dropped a bit at the semi, but he came back in the final, so it's all open.
Yeah.
That's what racing's all about. It's cool.
With the series still up for grabs, racers would now travel halfway around the world to Brazil for the next World Cup round.
The side of the sport that no one sees is the traveling side of things.
You'll go from one race and then pretty much everyone goes off in their separate ways and travels for, you know, to get to the next race, and you just see everyone the next Thursday, so no one ever really sees the stuff that goes on in between.
Oh man, travel this year has just been shit, been absolute shit.
I think for me and the whole Yeti team, 2006 has definitely been the year of the screwed up travel. Before Germany, we spent like 9 hours in the airport before our bikes turned up. They lost them at the terminal.
Airports, yeah, there's nothing to do with them. They're pretty boring places, really.
Killing time in airports? It's a good question.
Well, when we're in airports and we're there, nothing much to do. We like to steal the bikes that the employers used to get around the airport on. They're always good for a few slick tile cutty sessions and some little 180 fakey rollout type things, and basically just ride them until security gets up here and steals them off you. That's been a popular one this year. Also riding baggage carousels, just jumping on and curling up like a piece of bag and doing a couple laps and waving to the employees as you go past, and just seeing the looks on their faces, it's a pretty good one as well.
Pretty much living out of your suitcase. So I think so far this is my 16th or 17th week on a road.
It's not easy, you know, like always being away from home and like seeing the same faces every week, although everyone's pretty much pretty cool. It's, you know, it's always the same conversation. Oh, hi, how you going? Oh, when'd you get in? Oh, gee, where are you staying? That's great. Okay, see you next week. I mean, it's cool and it's good, but, you know, it does get time consuming, especially if you're not racing well or whatever. It just, you just kind of, right, where to next?
I think things like that are part of what makes a good racer, you know, being able to deal with the new things that different countries throw at you.
After Montana, I went to southern Brazil, to Florianópolis. No, what's the name?
Balneário Camboriú race. I think that's how you say it.
They know their shit there. Like, they know who's on what team, and you know, you are a celebrity to them. That kind of sounds funny, because when I think of mountain bikes, you know, there are no celebrities, but in Brazil, you are.
That's probably the best one for the year for the people. It's the people that make the event there, and you know, that's why it's cool to go to.
The Brazil World Cup, it kind of didn't matter what the track was like, just because it's such a different event, you know, with all the people, and yeah. I think we could be racing down a patch of grass and we'd be probably pretty stoked to go there.
And for these people in South America, how many times they see us, you know, they just look at us on videos or magazines, but this time we come to the country and, you know, they're kind of poor and they see us, they're the most happy people in the world.
I think everyone is excited. This is a cool place, you know. Your hotel's on the beach for a change and not up in the mountains, so it's a kind of change in scenery for all of us. You can wake up to the sun rising on the coastline instead of the cold snowy peaks in the Alps in Europe.
Sunny, having lunch on the beach in between practice. It doesn't even feel like a race. You know, you're in your board shorts, you're on the beach, having some shrimp. It's pretty good. It's good for the sport, man. The Brazilian fans love it, and it's cool to see us go to places that people appreciate us. The crowds love it, the fans come and swamp everyone for autographs and parts, and because they can't get half the stuff there, so it just builds the sport.
The culture down there was pretty sick. Banana trees and stuff, big rainforest jungles, monkeys and trees. I think you could cruise right down from the pits and have lunch with your feet in the sand, so that was pretty sick.
Swindlers?
Look at those things!
Wow!
It went pretty good for me. Like, I ended up fifth. It wasn't really my sort of track. I didn't enjoy riding it, but I managed to put a good result together, which at the end of the day meant points for the championship, which I was really happy with.
So what's the situation on Pete and Rennie's bikes?
They're still at the airport somewhere in Brazil. Which airport, I don't know. But it's pretty much it for the moment. They're pretty lost. So I just hope they turn up, period.
No bikes turned up. So we're thinking, oh, they'll come tomorrow. Like, the bikes will just come on the next flight and we'll get them. Got the first day of practice on Friday, still no bikes. Luckily for us, the bikes turned up Saturday after practice in the afternoon, so I managed to get my bike built, and Sunday was the first day on my bike. I got two practice runs, qualifying and then finals on my own bike. I want to yell when I see them mistreating you. What am I supposed to do? Please help me reveal the truth. I want to yell when them take away your dignity. No respect for humanity. How can we just let it be? Matthew Laikkanen beat me by 0.09 of a second.
Brazil was pretty good. I won, so I was quite stoked about that.
Matty was pretty happy about that, I guess. He'd never podiumed a World Cup before, and then his first podium was a win. So that's shows like the depth of racing these days, how many guys are quick.
He just had a great race and finally got on the podium and went straight to the top. You know, that's pretty amazing, you know, to win a World Cup's hard, and he pulled it off.
John, Manny,
James, Chris.
How's it feel?
Awesome.
First podium ever?
Yeah, first podium and being a top box, so I don't know, I'm just wordless. Last week I was so close, just missed the podium again, like, I don't know, sixth time, by that much. Just unreal.
To see him on the top step with Petey next to him and the rest of the guys filling it up was pretty amazing.
Matty Leahy-Conan was not the only first-time winner in Brazil. Rachel Atherton would win the women's class in convincing style and form.
I can't really believe it. It's cool. I'm stoked.
Greg ended up getting the flat tire and Steve finished second, so opened up his lead even more.
Sam Hill would crash in his race run, and Greg Minnaar would flat, causing Steve Pete to gap them both even further in his World Cup points lead.
I'm third now, Greg second, but me and Greg are pretty close in points. Steve has a pretty big gap. They pretty much just have to turn up.
Pardon me.
Yeah, he's won the overall. Speaking English.
And with more than a month before the upcoming World Championships, many riders would head to a mountain bike mecca, Whistler, British Columbia, for a mid-season break.
Yeah, Whistler is a really good place to go and ride. I mean, a lot of the races go there. I want to yell when I see them mistreating you. What am I supposed to do? Please help me reveal the truth. I want to yell when them take away your dignity. No respect for humanity. How can we just let it be? What am I supposed to do? I want to yell. I want to yell. No, we won't go quietly. I wanna yell. I've got hungry mouths to feed, yeah. Not gonna go on. No. It's just a good place, and like, everyone's super enthusiastic about their riding now. It's a whole different world. I mean, like, you never had, like, people just, it's just riding as a way of life there.
And it's just the fun. Everybody gets there for a festival and a bit of a party and a kind of mid-season break it's turned into now.
Whistler, I found out this year, is a super fun place to be. As soon as I got there, I was just gobsmacked by the amount of effort and work and passion that was put into, like, building all those trails.
Emil Cavalier is last year's junior world champion. Along with teammate Jared Rando, Emil will spend his time in Whistler training for the upcoming world championships later in the month in New Zealand. Greg Minnaar is last year's World Cup champion. He also won it in 2001 when he was just 19 years old. Following his flat in Brazil, Greg will refocus on the World Championships later in the month in New Zealand.
I see Greg is just a dominating force on our series right now.
He's just one guy, I think, if you beat, you know, you're doing well, because he's always got his head switched on and he's always up there. If you don't understand, then I just can't get it through. I was gonna say what led to hell.
What wish? I don't know one person in the second who don't like Greg, you know. Or maybe one or two, but it's maybe because of Jadis, because he's winning everything. And I don't care, no, no water. Look back, reflect, just stop and think, maybe it's all over. Reflect me, I don't know, and I don't care, no, no water. Waiting to count the moon, I don't care what you say.
Greg, along with selected riders from each country, will now travel to New Zealand to race a completely separate race from the World Cup Series, the UCI World Championships. The Worlds are a winner-takes-all, one-day race for the title of World Champion.
The World Championships is a competition of national federations, so it's a nation's cup, if you like. So unlike the trade teams racing against each other, the pro teams, like you would see, say, in the Tour de France or in NASCAR, where there are teams against teams of a commercial nature, this is where you represent your country.
The World Championships, they're a tough one because it's one day, you know, it's like time trialing down a hill is not hard enough, but it's, you know, for World Cup Series, you can still win the series and not have even won a race. But World Championships, it's the one run down the hill, that's it, bang.
It's the hardest race in downhill to win because there's so much pressure. There's so much pressure from your home country, from the fans, from your own teams, and you only really have one shot a year at it. Unlike a World Cup, you want to win a World Cup, you've got six or seven races where you can try and win a World Cup. But it all comes down to that one day, and it's such a weird old race.
Following his win at the U.S. National Championships a month previous to the Worlds, Duncan Riffle was the U.S.'s best hope for a medal. He had spent his season up until now racing internationally, while his U.S. teammates had stayed at home on the U.S. Norbis circuit.
Everybody who's there has earned the right to be there. The fastest people from every country are there. We're no longer representing a team or a company or a sponsor. You're representing yourself and your country.
You still are representing, you know, sponsors and stuff like that, but it's a little bit more, I don't know, especially with New Zealand anyway, it was a little bit more close to home, and, you know, you're more on the same team as all your buddies, you know, all your countrymen or whatever, you know, like all the Aussies.
Your federation have totally supported you to get there, and it's nothing to do with your team or sponsor, so the pressure to perform is pretty high.
You've got one chance, one day, on whatever course is put in front of you, with whatever weather conditions, there's no second chance.
New Zealand's Sam Blenkinsop is a favorite to win the junior men's world title. After injuring himself at the first round of the World Cup in Vigo, Blenkinsop came back strong, being the fastest junior at both the Mount St. Anne and Brazil rounds. For Blenkinsop, the pressure is on to perform on home soil.
Yeah, I've never had so much pressure in my life, pretty much. Just shitting my decks, pretty much.
Until the end of time.
Steve Pete is kind of, I guess he's like legend, I suppose. He always seems really stoked to be where he is, you know. Even if it's just winning a small race or winning the world champs, you know, or trying.
One of the oddest things involved in the whole world champ scene is Steve Pete not winning it yet.
It's going to be a travesty if he never wins worlds. You know, I think he's got the whole of the UK. The whole world wants Steve to win worlds. I mean, it's just a real shame that he hasn't won it, because he's been the fastest guy on a hill so many times. He's just never done it on that day. As he hasn't won it, it's become more and more pressure for him over the years. And it's become, it's his nemesis, isn't it? He needs to win it.
For Petey's protege, Brendan Faircloth, anything less than a win in the juniors category would be considered a failure. The world would prove disastrous for young Faircloth. He would crash in his race run and finish a disappointing 17th. After a crash in his seeding run that would seed him in sixth place, Kiwi Cameron Cole would lead the junior men's race with only one rider left to go, number one seed, Sam Blenkinsop. Sam Blenkinsop, silver medal. Sam would finish an amazing second place despite an over-the-handlebars crash in his race run.
Winner of the silver medal, Samuel Blenkinsop of New Zealand! Winner of the gold medal and world champion, Cameron Cole of
pretty incredible. Actually, I was rooting for both of them, but man, I mean, Cameron's solid run, played it smart, I think, and did a clean, fast run. I think Sam Blenkinsop just absolutely pinned that. He's going to be world champ one day, over the bars and only 1 second off, so good on them both.
It is this man that put New Zealand downhilling on the map in the late 90s. John Kirkcaldy would retire following his race run at the 2006 Worlds. During his 10-year career, Kirkcaldy would win two Norba titles and would be remembered as one of the most prolific riders to ever race downhill.
When I found out Worlds was in Rotorua, I figured that would be the best time to retire, and always wanted to retire while I was still somewhat competitive and still fast. Thanks to everyone that's helped me over the years, all sponsors and friends. There's a lot of you out there, and just been fun entertaining everyone in practice over the years. And you'll see me again, I'm sure. I'll be out there, but until then, ciao.
Duncan Riffle, 19th place, and the pulse of the race begins. Sam Hill now leads with only five riders left to go.
The whole time I was just worried I was going to get kicked out. Felt pretty confident after Greg came down and I'd beaten him, I think, 4 seconds. So when he came, then there was just Steve and then Randy to go.
Sam Hill, our leader now, and then target time has become an extraordinary 3:11.03.
Steve Pete would eventually finish fourth, while his teammate Nathan Rennie would finish third. Sam Hill, 2006 world champion.
I don't know what it is. There's something about world championships and the Brits and me that just don't seem to click. I'm going to be in a wheelchair trying to win that race, I think.
Yeah, it was just a relief, really. Something I worked pretty hard for, so I finally get it. It's awesome. Australian flags everywhere, kangaroos being thrown in the air. Not real ones, but inflatables.
World champion, Samuel Hill!
Third overall in points at the moment. 20 points behind Greg and quite a few behind Steve. He's been the only one that's been consistent all year, and both me and Greg have been pretty up and down, so
yeah.
I think Steve should be able to take that pretty easy.
Next up, the World Cup finals in Schladming, Austria. But first, two of New Zealand's best would ride their home trails after the biggest race of their lives. Justin Leob is the top-ranked Kiwi on the World Cup circuit, but a crash in his race run at Worlds would see him finish 49th. Joining him is the Junior World silver medalist and up-and-coming New Zealand downhiller Sam Blenkinsop.
Sam Blenkinsop, oh man, for sure the next Sam Hill.
He's going to be a contender for the elite world title, I think, in the future. I mean, he's almost there now. One more step and he's going to be a top three in the world guy.
At him and think, hey, this kid's 17, you think, you know, you don't really put that into perspective. When he matures a little bit more, gets a bit older, like in his 20s, he's just going to be a machine. He's going to be unstoppable.
After Rotorua, we went to Schladming for the final World Cup race. Schladming was the final round of the World Cup series, and I think it's fair to say that it's the best round of the year. Like, it's the best track for sure. The
track's so much fun. There's like hardly any pedaling. It's kind of my style of track, really. Just fast and jumps and real nice technical woods and stuff like that. All kind of bit of everything.
No pedaling. You could do this track chainless and still be reasonably competitive.
It's steep from the word go.
It seems like you're on a moto and the throttle's stuck. You know, you just, it's that intense the whole way down.
You know, it's now going into the last race with Petey with the comfortable 170 lead, and I think Sam's just behind me with 25 points or 24 points.
Everyone's on their game here. It's the last race of the year. Like, some people don't have anything to lose, and there's still a bit of a points chase on, so it's going to make for some good racing.
Following his disappointing Worlds finish, Brendan Faircloth was focused and poised for a top 10 finish in the last race of the year.
I think I'm kind of capable of it on this track. It's a good track for me, no pedaling in this. Pinning berms and corners, and I like that sort of stuff. So top 10, I'll be really happy with here.
It's an awesome track at Fermi. Just dead technical out the start gate, two pedal strokes, and that's it for the rest of the track. You know, just flowing down.
It's an amazing track. It just seems to flow all the way down.
Yeah, proper downhill track. Just beats you up. Just real rough braking bumps, turns the whole way down, and I think everyone has a smile in practice just the whole day.
Coming into this race in the finals, I'm 178 points clear ahead of the pack in the overall series. The guys that can beat me at this race is basically it's just Greg Minnaar. He's in second.
But like the top five till ninth place, there's only I think 44 points or something. So it's going to be really tight with from places 5th to 10th. So I'm sitting ninth right now, so I'm pretty much in the middle. Chris is just like breathing my back pretty much, a few points behind, so it's going to be tight.
Coming into the last race, all Steve needed to do pretty much was have a safe run and get down. And I was still sitting in third, Greg Minnaar was in second, about 20 points in front. So I wasn't in a position to try and win the championship, so I just wanted to try and win that race. And things turned out good. I ended up second overall.
Sam Hill won Slabbing again by a pretty good margin again. It's pretty like, it's like domination in that one track almost now. His confidence, like, it must be so high, especially coming into a track like that where he knows he's won by so much.
Sam made sure again he was the fastest person, you know?
For the third year in a row, Sam Hill would finish second overall in the World Cup Series. Third place overall finisher Greg Minnaar will now have young Sam Hill in his eyes as he prepares for the 2007 season. First place overall in the women's category would go to Great Britain's Tracy Mosley.
I do look up to Tracy a lot because she's been in it for quite a long time. She's put so much effort and so much, like, she really does want to win and want to be the best. But then Sabrina's up, ended up third in the World Cup Series this year, which is good, it's consistent. I was third last year, third in the World Champs, so I guess I'm number three.
But the most notable ride of the day would have to go to young Brendan Faircloth. After his disappointing Worlds, Faircloth would finish in impressive fifth place, beating his mentor Steve Peat in the process.
I'm happy with this, and I'm happy I'm the fastest junior today and got the overall, and the juniors couldn't be any happier really.
Steve Peat, 2006 UCI World Cup champion.
I knew I had to come in the top 20 to keep the leaders jersey after qualifying, and that's what I did, so the jersey stays with me.
2 months after claiming his third World Cup title, Peat would already be training for the upcoming 2007 season in his hometown of Sheffield, England.
Same as it ever was. Same as it ever was. Same as it...
Steve Peat for me is a special person, you know, like where he's kind of just a mellow guy that just wants to have a beer with everyone.
He likes to give back too. He's got, you know, he's had riders coming through the ranks, and Mark Beaumont, Brendan.
Peat has had a knack for finding, coaching, and sponsoring upcoming British downhill talent. Neil Donoghue, Mark Beaumont, and Brendan Faircloth all got their start under the mentorship of Steve Peat.
He gave me my first ride, like sponsored me for Royal. He's always helped me and always given me advice, and he's always like, he's open to anyone to go, you know, anyone to go and ask for advice if Steve may give it.
To be honest, I wouldn't be in the position that I am without his help. So he's opened my eyes to training and also to being strong in my head for racing and so many different things.
He's definitely an idol. Won't big him up too much and say he's my hero, but he's pretty close. He's a man to beat, I reckon, on every track, every terrain, everywhere really.
You never count PD out. If you have an injury or not, it doesn't matter, he will still race.
Am I right? Am I wrong? And you may say to yourself, my God, what have I done?
Josh Briceland is the latest of Steve Peat's junior riders. After a successful season racing the British National Series, Briceland will race his first World Cup in 2007 at the opening round in Vigo, Spain.
Steve, he's getting on a bit now, and he's still just pinning it and up there with all the big boys. Every week in, week out, he's the one to beat.
Anyone who can be on top of a sport for as long as he has, like, just to adapt to all the different changes in the bikes and everything, they're obviously doing something right. And he still seems as hungry as ever.
It sucks, man. The older he gets, the faster he goes. He's not letting off. He won't let the youngsters get it that easy, you know?
You know, these youngsters still really struggle to beat him on a whole season. You know, they'll beat him here and there, but consistently he's the best, always.
I don't think he's going to slow down in the next few years, you know? I think he's going to be still on top of that podium for years to come.
Steve hasn't slowed down at all as the time goes on at all, but like I said, he's still young at heart.
It's just been cool. I met my wife through racing, and it's a massive part of my life. I wouldn't swap it for anything in the world. It's been great. It's been a magnificent ride, and I want to keep it going.
With the 2006 season officially in the record books, the riders returned to their home countries to begin preparations for 2007. Last year, the Australians confirmed that they are the most well-rounded group of riders on the circuit.
For Gravesy to just mix it up and like be so high up in the World Cup for four cross and still like have some killer results in the downhill as well. It's like really good all-round rider, just a good, awesome mountain biker. Can't you see that I'm busy now? I've got an act for some trouble, believe me. And lately I've been trying to block it out. I've got a strange little other side, a temptation that I try to hide. Like, it's amazing how many people that I've met through racing. You sort of instantly make friends. You've got a common interest to racing bikes. That you've been knowing what I'm going through. The same thing happens. The same thing happens. But I've been thinking I could be a better man, see. Instead of taking life for granted, I feel lucky to be alive. Good how I feel inside. And from now on, we're taking big strides. Ooh, yeah. Ooh, yeah.
love riding bikes. Doesn't matter what it is, you know. I love going for a cross-country ride, you know. And just love riding. It's so fun, you know. I'd do that over anything, you know. Count your mistakes, think again, because I know that you can. I can't serve. I'm pretty sure that we grow every day based on simple mistakes that we make. Like, there ain't no easy way. Say it again, there ain't no easy way. Ooh, and I can tell when I look at you. Ooh, you know exactly what I'm going through. The same. You know, having a 100% solid race run is pretty hard to come by, and I think that's what everyone's chasing, you know. And all surfers are chasing the ultimate wave, and we're chasing the ultimate downhill run. You can always go faster, you can always be fitter, you can always be stronger. It's just a never-ending process, so it's really addictive, and once you get into it, it's hard to stop. I mean, I know now that for the rest of my life, I'll always be riding a bike. I'll just never be shy to get on a bike, and I'll never be shy to pull a wheelie. I mean, if I can pull a wheelie at 60 years old, then I'm stoked, right?
I love race day. I love the tension. I love the anxiety. I love not knowing who's going to win and all the build up to it. And then there's this traveling family that I've been part of for, I mean, nearly 15 years on the World Cup Tour. And it you just become family. It's hard to explain. To leave it is to divorce it, and I'm not ready for that.
Just the act of downhilling is enjoyable. Just bikes are just fantastic. Love bikes.
Nesting himself in Perth, Western Australia, Sam Hill proved to everybody in 2006 that he is one of the fastest, if not the fastest, downhill racer in the world right now.
Sam Hill, for me, is someone, he's the greatest danger man on any day. If he gets all his pins in a row, he's totally unstoppable.
He is really on top of his game, and he knows what to do and knows how to do it. And you know, I'm happy when I beat him because I know how good he is. So, like, it's I think Sam's really good for the sport.
I think he's lifted the bar, so everybody's going to go home this off season and push and train really hard. And I think next year when you come back, you're going to see a lot of talent from the other remaining riders in the World Cup, and I think it's just going to bring the sport up in general. Destination unknown, but I have this vision in my mind's eye. This is my decision. Every single dream, every single fantasy, every single love, every single enemy, it's all for me. Do you believe that you can change the world? Haha, do you believe that you can change the world? Freedom to speak, freedom for truth, your freedom to do what the fuck your heart wants you to do. It's all for you. Lifestyles of the rich and the famous, is it all a dream or can you attain it? Everybody seems to be selling out their souls for the fame we fucking love, sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Maybe one day we will realize that the answer's in our heart, but we're killing our minds and it's tearing us apart. One life to live, I'm gonna make it positive for this world that we live in. This is my decision. Time for me to make it on my own now. Here I go, watch me go where I go now. I don't know where I'm gonna go now.
I think downhill racing in one word is sort of a jigsaw.
I'd say intense. Flat out.
Loose.
I'd say my one word to describe downhill racing is loose.
Time.
You're racing with time?
I think it's like passion. That's what I'd say. Mountain bike has just been part of my life for such a long time. And like from a hobby it became a job. And then you've always had to have the passion to do it, otherwise you wouldn't get that far.
Just have to say fun. Just so much fun. I couldn't live without it now.
Downhill racing in one word would be just fun.
Seven races in seven countries on four continents, and it all goes by in a blink. Together these riders will form lifelong friendships, doing something so common to so many people, riding a bike. And while the destination is unknown, one thing is, that what these riders all do is done between the tape.